where it began. I can't begin to know it, but then I know it's growing strong. Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
And welcome to the 10th Art Wednesday. This is actually the last in our series for the time being, last in our series of art during lockdown. Steve and I agreed that we would do 10, and actually it's fitted rather well, hasn't it? Because we've just discovered that very soon you will be able to go to art galleries in person rather than listening to me and watching artworks on a screen. So do take advantage of that. Go just over the river to Tate Britain, go along the river to Tate Modern, go over to Trafalgar Square and pop to the National Gallery. They're all so close. If your legs are in good working order, then you can probably walk to all three of those galleries if you're living in Oval. So we're in an extraordinarily privileged position, actually, once the galleries reopen for looking at artworks in the flesh. So do go and do that. I hope that you will. On that note, I thought that we would finish our series by having a think about the city, and in particular about the City of London, which seems to be making itself heard through my window in a particularly prominent way. I wonder what your picture of London is. If I was to ask you to paint a picture, a mind picture perhaps, of London, I wonder which bit you would pick. And if I were to ask you to think of an artwork that depicts London, I wonder which one you might think of. Some people might think of something like this. This is James Abbott McNeill Whistler in 1872 giving us a painting called Nocturne, Blue and Silver, Cremorne Lights. And it's beautiful, isn't it? It's absolutely lovely. It's a hazy, gorgeous, delicate image of the Thames looking west from Battersea. You can see the chimneys of Battersea on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side you can see the lights of Cremorne Pleasure Gardens, which would have been a little bit like the 19th century Spring Gardens at Vauxhall. Again, a pleasure gardens in the 19th century, where there would have been all sorts of types of entertainment, some of it savoury, some of it a little bit less savoury, a fairground kind of atmosphere. And Whistler actually chooses to draw back from both of those things, both of those aspects of what would have been modernity for him in the 19th century, and to give us a very sort of hazy picture of the surface of London through the mist of the Thames. Now that's actually probably a result of pollution. So Whistler is sort of using the hazy quality of the air to give us a slightly distanced view rather than drawing up close. Perhaps he's afraid that if you draw up too close, you'll see the dirt and the grime rather than the hazy beauty. Last week I encouraged you to look closely like Dürer. Well, here Whistler is doing the exact opposite and giving us a slightly romanticised image perhaps of the City of London by the river. Perhaps you think more of something like this. This is Simon Patterson's The Great Bear from 1992. It's a very famous piece of art by now, and it's a doctored version of the 1930s tube map. And if you look closely at that, I don't know how well you can see this on the screen, then you'll see that each of the tube lines has been turned into a different group of people's names. So there's a line for the philosophers, there's a line for film stars, there's a line for Italian painters, and some of those intersections are quite amusing. Darwin seems to come out on top at one particular intersection, and Pythagoras is given one of the intersections on a triangle. So there's some witticism in there. Perhaps that's more your kind of picture of London, a place where chance encounters and juxtapositions and witticisms can take place, a London that is alive with conversation perhaps. Two very different images from very different periods in the history of art. But actually I didn't think that we would look too closely at either of those today. I thought that we would have a look at three images which help to sum up one particular area of London, and that is the area near the embankment, near Embankment Station, to be precise. So here is a piece from 1934. This is Embankment Gardens. And in some ways to us now, this seems like quite a nostalgic image, perhaps even more nostalgic than it would have seemed before lockdown. In many ways, that image of Embankment Gardens looks a lot like a delightful summer evening in 2019. There is no sign there, is there, of social distancing. People are enjoying those gardens. People are playing musical instruments in the foreground there. You get a little bit of a caricature almost of an accordionist and a singer. There's a bandstand in the middle. People are sitting around listening, sitting close together, interacting. The fashions betray the fact that this is from 1934, but otherwise this is quite a familiar image to us, perhaps, of the ways in which London's parks and green spaces have always been used. And perhaps we're looking forward, as lockdown starts to be eased, to a return to something like that. Here's another image of just around the corner from here. If you came out of that gateway from Embankment Gardens, you'd find yourself at Embankment Station. And perhaps this is a familiar sort of image to anybody who was used to commuting before lockdown came about. This is Leon Kossoff's The Flower and Fruit Stalls Embankment from 1995. And the sort of hustle and bustle of that, the particular angle at which he's chosen to paint people and the very cursory brushstrokes that he's used help to really imbue that with a quality of jostling and people rubbing against each other. And it's a sort of spontaneous image of people who are passing through a station. Again, no face masks, no social distancing in place, an era that somehow suddenly seems very different to us from the one that we have been living through. And I wonder what your feeling is as we start to ease now out of lockdown, whether you are looking forward to going back to the way things were, or whether you are a little bit more apprehensive perhaps about some of the things that these paintings have represented to us so far. Perhaps you'd rather keep drawn back a little bit like Whistler and see things from a distance without too many people in the way, or perhaps you're looking forward to getting back on the tube. All sorts of things that might be going through our minds as we think about returning to the London that we knew, but not quite as we knew it. And so here is the crux of what I wanted to talk about, really. I think this is a piece which, whilst it's very different from some of the other pieces I've just shown you, actually can resonate with all of us. The other pieces that we've looked at are, in a way, part of what we might call a topographical tradition. Topographical simply means that they map out an image of place. They show us where something is. There's something about them that very clearly demarcates where this picture was painted. It's a picture as much about placement and geography as it is anything else. Now, the piece that I'm showing you now, this is by Rachel Whiteread, from 2005, this is not about a topographical representation of a particular place in London. Nonetheless, it is called Embankment, and if you look at that, you might start to see forms sort of stacked up. None of them represent a particular building, but you might see something like a dome that sort of resonates perhaps with something like St Paul's in the background of that series of shapes and forms that weave through the Turbine Hall at Tate Modern, or wove through the Turbine Hall at Tate Modern when this was on display there in 2005. I don't know if you're familiar with Rachel Whiteread's artwork or not. What she does, she has one method really, but she uses it in some really interesting ways, is she casts interior space. So her most famous piece was to cast the inside of a house. It was a house that was being knocked down, and before it was demolished, she cast the whole of the inside of it in concrete. And then when the shell of the house was taken off, you had this sort of negative image of the interior of the house. But obviously you couldn't walk into it, you could only walk around it. Well, she's done the same thing here with a much more mundane object, with a cardboard box. And she started out with one particular box. She started out with a box that she found in her mother's home after her mother's death. And it was a box that she remembered from childhood, stacked in her toy cupboard next to her jigsaws with one set of things in it. Again, reused for Christmas decorations, used over and over again over the years to hold different objects. And the surface covered in layers of sellotape where it had been sealed, opened up, resealed. So that box became a sort of shrine to memory in a way. And in casting the inside of that box, she created a permanent solid image of its interior, minus its contents, but its contents became the sculpture in a way. And As a result of that, she then decided to cast a number of different boxes. So it's not all a replica of the same box. If you look closely, you can see a number of different sized boxes and packages that are represented through their internal negative space in this installation. And she has taken all of those packages and stacked them up to create for us effectively a cityscape. If you weave your way through that, you feel perhaps as though you're traveling through on the river or at the edge of the embankment, looking up at this vast cityscape created by boxes. And it strikes me that in many ways, if one box embodies the contents of one person's box of memories, in a way, or the particular experience of one individual, that actually that cityscape that she's created is made up of hundreds of thousands of memories of individual unique perspectives that are represented by an internal space. And that, I think, really resonates for me with my understanding of how lockdown has been. I think we've all experienced it in slightly different ways, depending on how much you've had to stay inside, depending on whether you've been a key worker and you've had to be at work, depending on how far you've travelled from home, depending on how you have been isolated with people or without people, how much time you've spent in the four walls of your house, what the four walls of that house look like. Everybody's experience of lockdown is going to have been slightly different. And if those boxes come to sort of represent the four walls, metaphorically or physically, that we have been inside during lockdown, then actually what we can start to realise is that between us, we're building up a kind of bank of memories, a bank of nostalgia that represents one communal experience, which we can understand as a new version of London, perhaps. I wonder how lockdown will seem to you in years to come. For some of us, it might seem like a fairly short blip, something that has clipped our wings for a while, but that was relatively short-lived and maybe didn't have any lasting impact. For some people, it will have changed absolutely everything. It will have had devastating consequences or effects. Or maybe it will have had some very positive, life-changing, affirmative effects. For some people, it will have seemed interminable. And for other people, it will seem to have come to an end fairly quickly. And I wonder what coming out of that is going to feel like for each of us. For some people, we'll want to leap out of the box as quickly as we possibly can and return to whatever normal was before, returning to the hustle and the bustle. For other people, just opening one flap of the lid might be something that is very hard to do. You might be feeling very cautious about that for a variety of different reasons. Maybe you've been shielding, and actually that experience has left you very apprehensive about the world outside. Maybe each of us has a responsibility to help each other come back to a communal experience of life. Whatever our experience has been, God says this, and these are some words that I came to just before lockdown, actually. I was preaching at the evening service the week before we had to close our doors, and these words sort of sprung out at me as I was looking at images of the centre of Rome, completely depopulated. We didn't see London being locked down in quite that way at that time, but very shortly afterwards we saw images of Trafalgar Square looking exactly the same. So these are some words from Zechariah, which really spoke to me at that point, I think. Zechariah chapter 8, verses 4 to 6. Once again, men and women of ripe old age will sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each of them with cane in hand because of their age. The city streets will be filled with boys and girls playing there. This is what the Lord Almighty says. It may seem marvellous to the remnant of this people at that time, but it will it seem marvellous to me, declares the Lord Almighty. Will it seem marvellous? God is the one person who saw all of this coming, and he saw how each of us would come out of it. He sees how every single one of us has experienced it, and he knows what our concerns are. But he has a promise for all of us that one day we will see the streets filled with people sitting, relaxed, calm, playing, enjoying life again. We also know, don't we, that in the Bible, the city is very often an image of heaven. And I think the image of Jerusalem that God gives us in this passage is both about the real Jerusalem, the exiles returning to it, and about the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven, recognisable and yet unrecognisable, very familiar and yet perfected. Now, I'm not suggesting that we're about to go into any perfect version of London. I think probably anything but, in many ways. But I do think that there are ways of coming out of all of this and saying, actually, these are some things that I have learned that I would like to preserve. What would would you like to bring out of lockdown with you? Maybe we could hope that London will be a kinder place. Maybe it'll be a place where conversation is more precious eventually, where we appreciate bumping into people who are different from us in the way that that Great Bear Tube Line shows, all of those chance encounters that maybe amuse us on the Tube Line picture, but that are expansive in giving the Tube Line the title The Great Bear, Simon Patterson makes of London something much bigger than it is, a constellation, in fact. I wonder, as we come out of our individual boxes, our individual experiences, what picture of heaven that might give us? What can we learn from looking at our city about what God promises us from his future Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, the city where we have our citizenship and where everything will be better than we could possibly imagine now, because it's higher than what we have now. It's beautiful. Not just because of hazy pollution, not just because of pushing the things that we don't want to see into the distance, but it's truly beautiful. And we can look forward to that.